from the moment I decided I was going to do this, keeping it secret was like 50% of it, because I didn't, you know, I think there's a problem now where there's too much access to things. So these movies, they get announced long before they're even greenlit half the time. So you hear these things get announced and then they don't happen. Or then there's like 5,000 different set visits and all these different stills and clips and then 50 trailers and teasers. And by the time the thing comes out, you're already over it. So it's like, if you're not going to open on 3,000 screens and you don't need to buy that opening weekend of whatever the box office is, then who cares? So instead, it's like, just announce it by showing it and being like, by the way, here's a new Hatchet movie, watch it now, and then immediately take it out on tour. The fact that we were able to keep it secret and that nobody spilled is a miracle. But on Tuesday night in LA, when I announced what everyone was really about to see, and that theater just stood up and was screaming, I mean, there were people crying, and I mean, it was all worth it. After Hatchet 3, I went through a really dark, dark period. And until very recently, I think not a lot of people knew just how bad it got. And that was what I had to say with this movie. It's the funniest out of all of them. It's the most fun film out of all of them. So you would think, all right, so if he was coming out of this depression, is this going to be like super serious and dark? But no, I was able to work that stuff out through comedy and through jokes. But I had something new to say with it. And for those that know me personally, when they watch the movie, they can see all of that pain getting worked out. But I mean, the one audience we've now seen it with, I mean, they're just laughing and cheering. But it feels more like the first one, where in the beginning I did have something to say. The second and the third, it's not that I didn't have something to say, it was a continuation, it was all one story. But now that this picks up 10 years later, I was free of that to start with something new. The mythology of Victor Crowley is gonna slightly change going forward. Like, I've changed the rules a little bit, but yet stayed true to what the fans already know and love. It's not like Victor Crowley's now suddenly gonna be shooting machine guns or like, he's not going to turn into Chucky or something like that, but it's revamped a little bit. Well, for horror fans, we get attached not just to the characters, but to the actors that portray them. I mean, these are icons to us. We love them. And it's so disrespectful the way that some of these slasher franchises have been handled over the years, where they just didn't care. Or maybe the actor who originally played the part just wasn't that attached. This is very different. I mean, when you look at the credits, it's most of the same crew that comes back. It's the fact that we just had a 10-year anniversary screening where all the actors coming, they knew that we weren't going to show the first movie. But every single one of them was there. And at the end, when we did a Q&A and you had the cast of all four films all standing there together, when have you ever seen that in the history of horror? It doesn't happen. So there's something very special about this, and I think the fact that it isn't a studio movie, it's an Arriscope movie, it's my movie, there's this love to it and a friendship and a camaraderie where we stick together. And because, believe me, nobody wants to do it. When I said, hey, I'm going to do this, Kane was the only one who was happy. The rest of my crew wanted to kill me, like, because these are miserable to make, miserable. And they're not fun at all. And then you get a moment like tonight, and when you hear that first laugh or cheer, and then you're like, that's why I did it. That's why I did it. It's addictive. It's like drugs. The one thing the past few years have taught me is that you can't plan out anything, because I had planned to never go near this thing again, and now all of a sudden, look. So as far as if there's going to be more, that really depends on the fans. I mean, it's a business, and if people keep pirating and not paying for it, then no, there's not going to be more. I mean, this was incredibly hard to pull off. A lot of us paid to work on this because we wanted all the money on the screen and more money than we even had. I mean, when you see how big it looks, I mean, that's the thing with these movies. The concepts, the scripts, they get bigger and bigger and bigger, whether the budget's getting bigger or not. The budget it doesn't matter to us. We do what we need to do. So maybe there will be more. Of course, I have a plan, but we'll see. As far as the Holliston documentary being announced, it's still in the very early stages, after seeing To Hell and Back, the Kane Hodder documentary, I felt like these guys were capable of telling the story. Because what I loved about Kane's documentary was that it's not about, and then I played Jason in this movie, and then I played Jason in that movie. It's a very personal story about somebody who overcame huge hurdles and didn't give up. And Holliston is, it's similar in that, I mean, that show took 13 years just to get shot. And then when it was finally hitting, we lose a main cast member to heroin. Our network gets dissolved. I mean, it was over. And then I'm in hospital rooms and therapist office think, I mean, I shouldn't be here today. And but I am, and the show is still going to go on. And so I think it is an important story for people to hear. So I'm, to be completely honest, I'm very nervous about it because there's still a lot of things I have not said publicly. There's things that maybe only like two or three people in my life even know. And if this documentary goes as planned, I'm going to have to open up. And so I've been like leaning on Kane for that. Because I know in his documentary, he ended up saying a lot of things he did not expect to say. And even the introduction for Victor Crowley on Tuesday night, I ended up saying things I didn't even know I was going to say. So, but I think it needs to come out. And I think it's important for other people to hear who are going through similar things. Because there is a light at the end of the tunnel. There always is. There's always a way out. And it does get better. It just sucks that time is the only thing that's going to heal. And sometimes it takes a lot of it. But it does get better.
Why, of all the amazing horror characters, is Victor Crowley such an icon, and why you think he's so beloved by fans?
Good question. I think it's partly his backstory. You know, a lot of people can identify with what some of the stuff that Victor Crowley went through. Maybe not so much of what he does as an adult, but exacting revenge on people that wronged him seems to be something that people can identify with. So, and it's a fun character to watch. He is just so brutally violent with indiscriminate violence. He doesn't care who it is. He's going to f*** up. Sorry if that's not good language.
Language we love at this festival. And obviously, the mere existence of this film is a surprise for fans. Can you talk about that unique aspect of this production and what fans can expect when they do now finally see the real film?
Yeah, just the fact that we had to keep it secret for so long was something I didn't think would happen, first of all. I never thought everyone would keep the secret, everyone involved in the production of the film, because we had some new crew members that were not anyone we've worked with in the past film. So sometimes those people are the hardest to convince, don't give this away. It'll ruin it for the audience if they know it exists. So being at the screening on Tuesday in LA, here comes Lynch. Lynch is gonna do something. Ah, that's Lynch for you. Got Lynch. it's just a fantastic character. I love doing it, and I'm happy to be back. And this might be Victor at his most brutal.
There's always that level of expectation with each new installment, particularly of a franchise that has as devoted a following as this. What do you think is unique about this installment? What do you think it gives fans that they haven't from the previous Hatchet films?
Still has the comedic elements that Adam is so good about writing, but it has an interesting storyline considering the first three movies took place over one weekend, back to back to back. Then this one's 10 years later, so there's a lot of interesting character type things that happen in this one. There's a couple scenes this time where he almost looks like he delights in doing something brutal while someone else watches. Something we haven't seen before. He would be brutal to people just when he encounters them. But there's one scene in particular where I do something to someone while another character is watching and saying, "You better not do that. You better not do that." And I do it. Something that really Victor has never seen before. Never done something violent to someone while someone is telling him not to do it.
Final question, do you have a message to those fans who are just exploding with excitement at the moment?
You have to, when you have the opportunity, you have to come and see this movie whenever it comes to your area. Come and see this movie, or I will fucking kill you.